pastor tell me one time, he said, my congregation told me they liked it when I sat down and preached because it didn't appear that I was fussing at it. It was more laid back. I don't want the message today to be distracted by my style or me, you know, walking on 3 inches of my pants cut and spitting cotton on the first three rows of a deck of bangs growing out like a cobra or anything. I will try to stay calm and collected. But if I've ever ministered a message that I know is the heart of God, this today is it. I'm not interested in the style of how I preach. I'm interested in the message that goes forth. I want it to be informal, but I want you to please pay attention to the words that we share today. I spoke last week a little bit at the end of the service about it's evident that a beautiful building is not going to grow the kingdom of God. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
I have found that good singing won't grow the kingdom of God. Can I get another amen?
Amen.
And strangely enough, I have discovered that even good preaching is not going to build the kingdom of God. I know some pastor friends of mine who can preach circles around me and are great teachers. And they struggle with some of the same struggles that we struggle with, of wondering, Lord, when is the magic Sunday going to be that we show up and what's been prophesied happens before our eyes? How many prophecies have we had here at this church that there was going to be standing room only and it was going to explode and God was going to bring revival and we were going to be a city set on a hill? And I'm still believing that, but I also know that prophecy is conditional. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
So today, I want us to look in the Word. And I want to see what I think is the key to not just growing the church. How many of you know that every pastor wants their local church to grow? And I hope that every congregant wants their local church to grow. But it's not so much about growing the church as it is building the kingdom. Jesus never asked us to build a church. He said, I'll build my church. But he wants us to build the kingdom. And the kingdom is larger than our little circle. But at the same time, the kingdom is made up of local churches. It's been said that if every mega church in the country shut down tonight and never opened their doors again, it would not make a ripple in the kingdom of God. But if half of the average size churches of 70 and below shut down, Christianity would come to a dead halt in America. So today, I want us to talk about some things that if we don't take it to heart, we will just keep going like we're going with our little bunch, happy and loving one another, and glory hallelujah, and pass the ammunition. But I don't think any of us want that. I think all of us really want to see the kingdom of God grow. And as Pastor Don preached last week, and if you did not get that message or see that message, please go online and look at it or listen to it online or go to the bookstore to get the CD. He did not know what I was going to begin preaching today, but boy, did he lay the groundwork for it. He said, you know, the woods are full of lost people. Go get you one. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
And is there a person here today that would say, you know, Pastor, I just don't know anybody that's lost. Is there anybody here that does not know one person that's lost? Okay. So I think we're preaching to the right crowd today. And I know beyond a shadow of doubt, pastors won't admit this, but there's times that we preach things that we're not real sure God even believes it. But we like it. But today, I know beyond a shadow of a doubt, regardless of stomping, preaching, ranting, raving, that I'm ministering a message today that is the very heartbeat of our Father. Beyond a shadow of a doubt. I want you to turn with me to 2 Kings, chapter 7. 2 Kings, chapter 7. We're going to start reading with verse 3. Second Kings chapter 7, begin to read verse 3. Now there were four leprous men at the entrance of the gate, and they said to one another, "Why are we sitting here until we die? If we say we will enter the city, the famine is in the city, and we will die there, and if we sit here, we die also. Now, therefore, come let us surrender to the army of the Syrians. If they keep us alive, we shall live, and if they kill us, we shall only die." And they rose at twilight to go to the camp of the Syrians, and when they had come to the outskirts of the Syrian camp, to their surprise, no one was there. For the Lord had caused the army of the Syrians to hear the noise of chariots and the noise of horses, the noise of a great army. So they said to one another, "Look, the king of Israel has hired against us the kings of the Hittites and the kings of the Egyptians to attack us." Therefore they arose and fled at twilight and left the camp intact, their tents, their horses, and their donkeys, and they fled for their lives. When these lepers came to the outskirts of the camp, they went into one tent and ate and drank and carried from it silver and gold and clothing and went and hid them. Then they came back and entered another tent and carried some from there also and went and hid it. Then they said to one another, "We're not doing right. This day is a day of good news, and we remain silent. If we wait until morning light, some punishment will come upon us. Now therefore come and let us go and tell the king's household." Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for your anointing upon this word today. Give us ears to hear, hearts to understand, but wills to obey. To be not only just hearers of the word, but doers only. I thank you for touching my lips with a call off the altar. Touch our ears as well. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I've entitled this message, "Hiding and Hoarding, Sitting and Soaking." Hiding and hoarding, sitting and soaking. A little background on this story was that there was a severe famine in Syria. And it got so bad that there was nothing to eat, and the head of a donkey sold for $50. And that's pretty bad, but get this. A pint of dove poop sold for $3. Now, that's bad. Can I hear an amen? In chapter 6, verse 25, that's what it says. A donkey head. How many of you just love donkey head soup? You don't eat donkey's heads. You eat donkey's heads if you don't have the rest of the donkey. Or you have nothing to eat. And there were four leprous men that were at the gate. And these four leprous men, today for purposes of this message, are going to represent most of us in the church. So the details about these leprous men are what we're going to build this message around today. And I want you to see how these leprous men compare to most of us in the church who are hiding and hoarding and sitting and soaking. First of all, I want you to notice their condition. Can you say their condition? It says there were four leprous men. These men were leprous. And how many of you know that if you were leprous, not only were you sick, you were separated. If you saw anybody coming near you, you had to cry out what?
Unclean.
Unclean. Unclean. Now what would that do for your self-esteem? Go to the mall and you got to holler, "Unclean, unclean," so people can walk on the other side of the pathway for you. They were outside the walls, it says. They weren't inside. They couldn't come in. They were limited to where they could go and what they could have access to. They couldn't go many places because of their leprosy. And the worst thing about their condition was they were slowly dying. Now, as we compare these lepers to us, this is going to be very simple, okay? I'm going to tell you about the lepers, and I'm going to tell you how we compare to them, okay? Here they were, separated, leprous, outside the city, dying. How many of you know every one of us who were once lost, and how many of you were once lost? We were outside the gate. Come on, somebody. We were dying. We were separated from God. And you know what? We were in a pitiful condition, and we were unclean, and nobody or nothing would want to help us. Every one of us, at one time in our life, were just like these lepers. We were outside the gate. We couldn't come in. We couldn't play, as it were. We had to scream, unclean, unclean. And we were dying in our condition. And it was going to really kill us. I mean, you know, we were really going to die in sin if something didn't happen. This brings us to our next thing about these lepers. I don't want you to just see their condition, but I want you to notice their conclusion. Look at verse 3b through 4. It says, "And they said to one another, why are we sitting here until we die? If we say we will enter the city, the famine is in the city, and we shall die there. And if we sit here, we die also. Now therefore, come and let us surrender to the army of the Syrians. If they keep us alive, we shall live, and if they kill us, we'll only die." Look at their conclusion. While sitting in their pitiful condition, they came to a marvelous conclusion. Here's what they said. "Why are we sitting here till we die?" Duh. They recognized that death was imminent if they didn't do something. "We've got to move." You know what they said? "Hey, if we sit here, we're going to die. If we go into the city, we're going to die. There's nothing to eat. Even if we surrender to the Syrian armies and they kill us, what have we got to lose? We're going to die anyway." Yeah. Come on, somebody. Yeah. "We've got to move from where we are, so we're going to go to the Syrian camp." Y'all have heard me say this a gazillion times. If we keep on doing what we've been doing, we're going to keep on getting what we've been getting. If we just sit in our sin, we're going to die. We've got to move. Now, how does this compare to us? There came a time in each of our lives when each one of us had to come to a conclusion that if we stayed in the condition we were in, we were going to die separated from God. How many of you know that was the truth? We were going to die alienated from God, separated from God, die in our lost condition if we didn't do what? Make a decision and move from where we were. We had to, each one of us, respond and believe that the Lord God Almighty would save us alive, just what they said about these Syrians, and have mercy on us. How many of you are glad He did? Amen. Hallelujah. You came to that conclusion, and look at you today, you're a child of God. So we see their condition, we see their conclusion. But thirdly, I notice their confusion. Look at their confusion. Look at verses 5 through 7. "And they rose at twilight to go to the camp of the Syrians. When they had come to the outskirts of the Syrian camp, to their surprise," there it is, "no one was there. For the Lord had caused the army of the Syrians to hear the noise of chariots and noise of horses, the noise of a great army. So they said to one another, 'Look, the king of Israel has hired the kings of the Hittites and the Egyptians to attack us.'" Therefore, what did they do? They got up and got the heck out of Dodge. They left everything behind. Their donkeys, their horses, their gold, their silver, their bread, their wine, their clothes, everything, and fled for their lives, the Bible says. Now, the confusion of these lepers is this. They expected that when they approached the outskirts of the Syrian camp, either they would be in prison or shot dead where they stood, and not even get in. But to their surprise, when they got there to the outskirts, they didn't see a sentry guarding the door. They didn't see anybody. Who was there? Nobody. What happened to the Syrians? God had made them hear an army coming, and they fled. And to the confusion and to the surprise of these lepers, everything had been left behind. Now, where does that bring us? Before each one of us surrendered to Jesus, Satan gave us every excuse why we shouldn't be saved. Mm-hmm. How many of you, the Holy Spirit dealt with you a long time before you finally received Jesus? Now, for some of us, the first time the Spirit of God moved upon us, we, you know, whether it was as a child or whatever, we responded, thank God. But some of us, Satan gave us every reason, not only why we shouldn't be saved, but even this. He told us a thousand reasons why we not only shouldn't be saved, but why we couldn't be saved. And we thought in our mind, being saved is going to be a very difficult thing. Because Satan was saying things like this. You're too far gone. Anybody, Satan ever tell you that? You're too far gone. You can't be saved. What about this one? You've committed the unpardonable sin. Oh, that's one the devil loves to just worry the soup out of Christians. You've committed the unpardonable sin. What about this one? It won't last. No need for you to get saved. You can't change. It won't last. Or you just being a hypocrite. You're just going to be a hypocrite. You know that you don't. You know you're not right. You know you're not living. You know you. How many of you know you? Oh, I love this one. You don't need to get saved and go to church. You're just as good as them old hypocrites down there at the church. You're just as good as they are. You know, somebody said there's two reasons people don't go to church. One is because they haven't met a Christian. The second reason is because they have. Satan says things like this. I've got you tightly in my grasp and you're never going to get away. Some of us thought we couldn't be saved or shouldn't be saved because he said, this addiction you got, it's got too much of a hold on you and you'll never be free from it. You're always going to be like you are. You'll never enjoy the bounties of the kingdom. You can go on to church and you can act saved and you can take your family to church, but you know what? You're never going to enjoy the bounty of the kingdom. But to our confusion and to our surprise, listen to this. We each discovered that Satan, come on somebody, Satan had absolutely no power to keep us from coming to Jesus. Come on somebody, you hear this? All the excuses Satan gave us of why we couldn't be saved, when we made that decision, we're going to do something, all the devils in hell could not keep your name from being written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Come on, somebody say amen. To our surprise, Satan had to flee, just like the Syrian army. He had to flee, and guess what? He had to surrender his hold on you and on me. How many of you glad Satan don't have a hold on you anymore? He had to surrender. He had to forsake the camp. Hallelujah. When we surrender to Jesus, Satan had to surrender his hold on us. So we see their condition. We see their conclusion. We see their confusion. But number four, I want you to notice their celebration. Verse 8a. And when these lepers came to the outskirts of the camp, they went into one tent and ate and drank and carried from it silver, gold, and clothing. Now I want you to notice something. These lepers, in a moment of time, discovered, hey, the famine's over. The celebration can begin. What did they find? Food and drink. You ever been really hungry? They found silver and gold. You ever been really broke? They found new outfits. You ever been really naked? Silver, gold, food and drink, new outfits, new clothes. Hey, everything, listen, everything they had been deficient in, now there's an abundance of. I mean, overnight. Did you know that when we came to Jesus, we found the living bread? Hallelujah. We found living water. He invited us to partake of the wine of the joy of the Holy Ghost. We have been given a name. We have been given an inheritance. Hallelujah. Listen, the tents have been plundered. We've been given a name, the name of Jesus. We are part of the family of God. And listen, our rags and our nakedness have been replaced when he put that robe of righteousness around our back. And there's nothing that Satan can do to get it off. Can somebody say amen? What a celebration we ought to be having, because we're clothed in His righteousness. We drink the new wine of the Holy Spirit. We've got the living water, the living bread. But then number five, how quickly things change. We see their conviction and their conclusion, their confusion, their celebration. Look at verse 8b, at their corruption. And went in and hid them. And then they came back and entered another tent and carried some from there and also went and hid it. How quickly we see celebration turning to selfishness. Do you see that? Instead of sharing what they had found, they immediately did what? Hid it. Rather than heralding the good news, they hoarded it. They quickly went from shouting and celebrating to sitting and soaking. You know what their attitude was? It's like many in the church. As long as I've got what I need, everybody else can go without tithe. Are y'all still with me this morning? What a picture of most of us in the church today. We've been given the riches of the kingdom. Listen to me, please. We've been offered life for death. We've been traded Jesus' righteousness for our rags. And what have we done with it? By and large, what have we in the church done with it? And I'm not talking about the church up the road. I'm talking about the church in general, but I don't pastor the church in general. I'm talking about legacy outreach. You know what we do? We've been given the riches of the kingdom. We've been offered life or death. We've been traded Jesus' righteousness for our rags. And what have we done when we find ourselves hiding and hoarding, sitting and sucking? I'm talking about us. Us good people out here in Pauline. Brother Brian Sneed, who was here last week. Church is in the Alamo Theater. You walk in, and then the first thing you see is 50 beer taps. Some of y'all would like that church. They show movies there. And he sent Pastor Steve a picture of one of the movies it's showing, and it's called The Perils of Pauline. And I just thought, boy, don't that go along with the message good. Here we are loving what we have. People getting healed, saved. God's paying people's bills, renewing their minds, letting love flow. We're in here clothed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. We're drinking the new wine, the joy of the Holy Ghost. One of the perils of Pauline is that we're not sharing with Pauline. We're sitting and soaking, hiding and hoarding. While those still in famine die without Jesus and go to hell, while we're having charismatic calisthenics in our beautiful building. God help us. We hide our light under a bushel. And instead of being a city on a hill, we're saints in the cellar. We lock the truth, the bounty, the clothing, the wine, the joy, the drink, the food, the fellowship, the love, the forgiveness, and the grace. We hide it behind the locked doors of our churches, and we're waiting for folks to break in and see what we're doing in here. That's not how this works. That's not how any of this works. Have you seen the Geico commercial? That's not how this works. That's not how the end of this works. We gorge ourselves on entire loaves, fresh baked from heaven's bakery and heaven's oven, while those outside are not offered a single crumb. We saints celebrate inside while sinners emaciate. We've become spiritual gluttons who have become saved, sanctified, and satisfied. And we sing, I'll fly away, let's get out of here, while 100 people every minute drop off into eternity without God. And we're happy about it because it ain't us. Notice their conviction in verse 9a. Thank God for 9a. Then they said to one another, we're not doing right. Can y'all say we're not doing right? It's gonna get about right here and it's gonna want to choke you. It's gonna feel like a pencil sideways in your throat. But let's see if we can say it. We're not doing right. Let's do it one clear your throat. One more time. We're not doing right. Now listen. This day is a day of good news. Well, you know the word gospel means good news. And we remain silent. We're not doing right. This is a day of good news and we remain silent. We're not doing right. Their conviction. They got convicted that they weren't doing right, Brother Calvin. We're not doing right. Say leper lesson. Say leper lesson. Here's a leper lesson. You don't have to be perfect to do the right thing. You don't have to have all your problems solved necessarily before you help somebody else solve theirs. Come on, these guys are still lepers. When they found the bounty gun, they didn't get instantly healed. They were still lepers. There's some of us in this place, all of our stuff ain't fixed yet. Some of us are still broken in some areas. And if you wait until you got all your brokenness fixed before you help anybody else, guess what? You ain't never going to help nobody because you're not going to leave this world completely fixed till you get to heaven. You don't have to be perfect to do the right thing. You don't have to have all your problems solved before you help somebody else solve some of their problems. This is a day of good news, they said. You know what they were really saying? We know something somebody else needs to know about. When will we as the church realize that what God gives us isn't just for us to hoard and hide and sit on and so, it's to share with other people. And he said, we remain silent. Church, can we just admit it that we good people? Don't admit that. You don't have to admit that. Everybody knows that, right? We all know we're good people. Can we admit that we're not doing right? Let's not allow legacy outreach to become legacy no reach. Let's don't let what's on the sign out here be a lie and false advertising. Let's don't allow legacy outreach to become legacy ingrown. You ever had ingrown toenail? Some churches are suffering from ingrown toenail, ingrowth. People actually said, Pastor, we don't like all these, not here. I mean, to clarify that. I've had pastors tell me that some of their people said, Pastor, we don't like these new people coming. We like our church like it is. I would say, duh, are they missing the point? We want to sit and soak, hide and hoard. This is my 47,000 pairs of new clothes. This is my 100 gallons of wine, and don't you touch it. This is my truckload of bread. You know what happens when you hide and hoard and sit and soak? Mold gets to it. We got churches in Spartanburg County. Their deacons meet, and all they talk about is what bank they're going to put their millions in this month for the best interest. God help you, and shame on you. I wish God trust me with about a million, see what we could do around here. It wouldn't be put in the bank for interest, I'll tell you that. Let's not allow legacy outreach to become legacy hoarders. Legacy sitters. Legacy soakers. legacy silent, or legacy light. Where is our conviction? Our conviction that what God has blessed us with is supposed to be shared and not just enjoyed by a handful of the holy few that just come and have a good time, and we don't even think about sharing what God does in here on Sunday with a soul Monday through Saturday. We feel like we've done our duty. I came to church, Pastor. My God, what you want me to do? I was here. Some of us have that mentality. That we show up, God's up there cutting cartwheels. Hey, they went to church one more Sunday. Hallelujah. Praise me. What God's blessed us with is not just for us within the four walls here. Look at the seventh fact. Their condemnation. The seventh detail, their condemnation. Look at 9b. If we wait on the morning light, some punishment will come upon us. If we wait in the morning light, some punishment will come upon us. You know what they're saying? We can't wait until later. We've got good news. We can't wait until later. Listen, we can't wait till morning light. You know what they're saying? Hey, we can't sleep on this. Oh, this is for our charismatic brother and sister. Can't wait for a word from God. I'm just waiting on God to lead me to witness. Mm-hmm. Have you read your Bible? I'm just waiting to fill lead. Get the lead out! You don't have to feel led to do something God's already commanded you to do. Are we going to get to that? We must act now. If we don't, some punishment. The margin in my Bible says some calamity will come upon us. The King James says mischief. But that word in the Hebrew there, mischief, calamity, punishment, in the Hebrew means this: moral evil, fault, to commit iniquity, to do wrong, to sin. Now, do you have your big boy britches on this morning? Your big girl britches. Any church, including Legacy Outreach, that is remaining silent, sitting and soaking, hiding and hoarding, ingrown rather than outreaching, according to the Bible, is doing wrong. Did you hear that? Is doing wrong. If we keep what God's doing in here and never take it outside and evangelize and share and witness and tell others what God's doing in here, we are not doing right. We're sitting, soaking, hiding, and hoarding. Any church that is ingrown rather than outreaching, the Bible says, according to the meaning of this word, is at fault. It's committing iniquity. How many of you thought that when we leave healed every Sunday and saved and satisfied and fed and restored and our minds renewed, that it's possible for us to leave this place in such a state of ecstasy and, oh, I just love my church, I love my pastor, I just love everybody, it's just a wonderful place. How many of us even goes through our mind for one second that when we go out of here and keep silent, that we're committing iniquity? It's in calamity. I don't know why the church isn't growing. I can tell you why. We're in peril. We're in punishment. We're in calamity. We're in mischief. If we don't outreach, we're going to shrivel and die. I can take you to churches today. I can take you to churches today that in 10 years, it will be an empty building because everybody there, all 12 of them, are 80 years old. They ain't going to live till Jesus comes. They can sing, "I'll fly away." They ain't going to fly away. They're going to be put in the ground. A church is not outreaching but is lukewarm. And Jesus said, I'll spew you out of my mouth. You know what he says? A church that is in wrong, not outreaching, hoarding, hiding, sitting and soaking, makes me sick to my stomach. And it makes me want to vomit. Somebody said one time, the Lord spits you out of his mouth, you're going to go to hell? Somebody said, well, it just depends on which direction he spits. Yeah. A church that is ingrown and not outreaching, according to this scripture, is committing iniquity against God and is not doing right. Church, I want us to do right. How many of you want us to do right? How many of you want to do right? How many of you want to be a part of a church that's doing right?
Amen.
And then look not only at their condition, their conclusion, their confusion, their celebration, their corruption, their conviction, and their condemnation. But finally, look at their confession. Verse 9c. Now, therefore, come, let us go and tell the king's household. Wow. Come, let us go and tell. Let's break this down. Us. Us. Who is us? All of us. One of them did say, well, listen. I'm a leper, you're a leper, we're all lepers. But see, I've only got four toes. You got nine. Why don't you go? You know, my nose is, it fell off back down a long time. I just don't look good. You're much more presentable. Your nose is hanging by a thread, but you got one, so why don't you go? Why don't two of us go? Why don't we just use the Pareto principle and 20% of us will go and 80% of us can stay here? No, he said, let us go. Not an appointed committee. Let us. Then, another big word, go. What part of go don't we understand? We're waiting on them to come. The Bible don't say, build a beautiful church out in the middle of a cornfield, and if you build it, they will come. That's field of dreams, not field of reality. We built it. They didn't come. And we're having to pay for it. Calm down. Calm down. I want to stand up on this stool. Go. Go means move from where you are and go. And then tell. That means to speak. Fluffy, speak, Fluffy. Speak. It means to share. Come, let us go does not mean now let us sit and soak. Now let us hide and hoard. But go and tell. Matthew 28. Look at Matthew 28. Matthew 28. Verses 19 and 20. There it is again. Go, therefore. And make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them. I mean, you can't teach without saying something. You can't go without moving. To observe all that I have commanded you, and I am with you always, even in the age. Anywhere God tells you to go, you can be sure, if he tells you to go, you're not going by yourself. He's already there. He's going with you. And guess what? Not only is he going with you, he's already got the Holy Ghost sitting there preparing the heart for Amen. Who he sent you to. One more place. Notice it, but let me see. Notice it didn't say select a committee. Therefore, all power is given to me to help you to select a committee. It didn't say all power is given to me to lay hands on the visitation team. Oh, I like this one. All power is upon me to tell the pastor, that's what we pay you for. You go. You go as a car that didn't make it. Every one of you go. Look at Isaiah. Turn back to the Old Testament, Isaiah 6. Oh, I like this scripture. God's asking every one of us a question this morning, and it's the same question he asked that Isaiah heard. In Isaiah chapter 6. See, many of us say, oh, I just wish God would speak to me. I'd do whatever he told me to do. Oh, really? Let me ask you this. Have you done? Oh, come on now. Come on. Get ready. Watch this. Have you done the last thing he told you to do? You will never advance with God past your last act of disobedience. You will never progress with God past your last act of disobedience. If he's giving you a simple something and you haven't done it yet, why do you think he's going to give you some deep revelation on what the third toe on the statue in Daniel means? He's wanting your toes to get to moving. Come on. Now look, Isaiah 6, 8. I also heard the voice of the Lord saying, oh, I want to hear the voice of the Lord. I tell you what, if you hear the voice of the Lord any time in your life, I tell you one thing he's going to say, go. He's bad about saying that. The voice of the Lord said, whom shall I send and who will go for us? Then I said, oh, glory to God. Now, this is where God jumps up on the throne and cuts cartwheels and gets his robe tangled up. You ready for this? When he hears one of us say, here am I, send me. God just has a holy fit when you say that. Who's going to go for us? Did you know he didn't say the Holy Ghost is going to go? Jesus is going to go. Jesus is already come. He's waiting for you to go. Who shall I send? God's with. How do you know the laborers is where the shortage is, not the labor? The harvest is plenteous, but it's the shortage of the harvesters. There's enough lost people in Spartanburg County that every church ought to have to be in a building program and having 10 services. Amen. What we got now? We don't have fishers of men. We got fish swapping aquariums. Amen. Jumping from church to church. Amen. Kingdom of God's not growing. Churches are just swapping fish. Here am I, send me. And God said, go and tell this people. Go and tell this people. Go and tell, go and tell, go and tell. Simply go and tell what you found. But Pastor, I don't know the Bible. You know Jesus? When they ask you to come and be a witness in court, they don't call the person that can make up the most flowery story. They don't call somebody that can be real dramatic or creative. When they call you to court to be a witness, all but listen, y'all, this is simple. This is as simple as we and Pauline can get it. When they call you to be a witness, all they want you to do is tell what you saw. Tell what you know. Don't add to it. Just tell you were there, weren't you? How many of you were there when you got saved? Were you there? See, God's not expecting you to go explain. Well, they might ask me something I don't know. That happens to me every day. You don't have to go explain. You don't have to go browbeat. You just go and tell what you found. Have y'all heard this phrase before? We are beggars telling other beggars where we found bread. We didn't bake the bread. We didn't buy the bread. We didn't plant the wheat that the bread's made out of. We just found it. Surely you can tell somebody where you found something. You don't have to be a theological expert to tell somebody where you found something. I go to a restaurant and eat, and I'll tell you about it. I know some good restaurants. Y'all know I do. I don't explain you all the ingredients. I just say, come and look what I found. I don't care what's in it. It's good. You will like it too. I have found something. We don't go into all the explanation of the ingredients and who the cook is and where he's from and did he wash his hands. We just say, they got good food here. Come on and eat it. Can we do that? If you can't explain the gospel, bring them here. I'll explain it. You get them here. Get their butts in here. I'll explain it. We'll let the Holy Ghost move among and let them let God explain it to them. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
See, not to browbeat them. You have to go get your biggest Bible you can find. But I want you to look at 9C back here in 2 Kings. Boy, this hit me this morning while I was kind of refreshing in my mind over this message. 2 Kings 7:9C. It says, now therefore come let us go and tell the king's household. And something just slapped me right in the head. Tell the king's household. I believe this is a prophetic word, if we'll receive it as such. A prophetic, powerful word. The king's household. What is it, Pastor? How is that prophetic? How should we receive that today? Oh, I know what it meant in the scripture, but let's look between the lines. Let's look deeper than the surface. What does it mean to us today at Legacy Outreach in Pauline, South Carolina, when it says, let us come and go tell the king's household? Listen, don't miss this. Here's what I believe it means. Prophetically, and we all said we know somebody lost, those who are presently in Satan's hold can be members of Jesus' household. If we'll just tell them, it's a prophetic word. God sees them already in the kingdom. If we'll just tell them, let's go tell the king's household. We need to tell these people that are lost that the blood of Jesus has already been shed. He's already raised from the dead. And as far as he's concerned, hey, all they got to do is receive it, and they're in. They can help plunder the tents and help them share the bread and the wine and the joy and the clothing of righteousness. God says, you're in. If you want to be in, whosoever will, let him come. Who is saved? The whosoever will. Who's lost? The whosoever won't. This is prophetic. Hey. You want to really blow somebody's mind? You may not know the Roman road from the day of Pentecost, but let's just go. Say this. Hey, did you know that you just this close from being in the king's household? What are you talking about, Luke? are people dying, starving. Our family members, friends, people next door, people we go to school with, we shop with, the person that checks our groceries out, puts gas in our car. It's probably your husband. But there are people starving and dying that we rub shoulders with every day. We go out of here with the smell of the bread of the kingdom on us, and we're not sharing it. You say, Pastor, how do you know I'm not sharing it? Because I see the brown family, not that family, the brown seats. There's too many empty brown chairs in here that ought to have a potential king's householder sitting in. I went to Roebuck Elementary and Dorman High School. Hadn't had math since I was in the seventh grade. But I do know this. This is deep, y'all. If every one of us bring one, we'll have twice as many. Ain't that deep revelation? We're all quick to tell people where to go eat when we've discovered a good restaurant. Just tell people what you got and where you got it. You don't have to be a theologian. When you're talking to somebody at work and they're hurting and they're people are begging us to share Jesus with them, and the devil's told us, it's like, well, nobody wants to hear what you got. They're dying to hear it. Literally. And if somebody says something and they get into their, well, I don't understand this, and why did God do this? And why, you know what the best line ever was is, and this, you can use this in any, you can use this in your marriage, you can use this sitting at the card table playing poker, you can use this at the restaurant, you can use this out in the middle of a bunch of heathens. When somebody says, gives you an objection, well, you know, I tried church once. You know what your comeback is? You don't have to bring out your Bible and say and quote scripture. All you have to do is say, you know, I used to feel the same way until. Amen. That's all you got to say. Right. Well, God can't ever use a divorced person. Hey, I used to feel the same way. But, well, I'm on drugs. God can't use me. God can't. Well, I used to feel the same way. Until. And then you simply tell them. I mean, you were there. You said you were there. You're a witness. I used to feel the same way until Jesus did this. Let me tell you what Jesus did for me. That's all you gotta do. You gotta drag him down a Roman road or threatening with, well, are you a pre-trib? Don't get into all that. I'm a pan-trib. It's all pan out. It's all going to pan out. I don't care when it comes. It's going to pan out. I used to feel the same way until. And just simply share. Where a beggar tell another beggar is where we found bread. We didn't buy it. We didn't bake it. We discovered it. Please don't hide it any longer. Don't pour it. Don't sit on it. Don't soak. Most of us know more than we're practicing. Most of us know more Bible than we're practicing. Mm-hmm. And please don't wait for a deeper revelation from God until you go and do what He's told you last. Well, I just don't feel called to go. Well, He's already said that book. This Bible is a going book. It's full of going. Now, this message can be like some other message that we leave today and say, well, that was good. Please don't tell me that you enjoyed this message when you go out. Because if you do, I'll do something about it. I don't want to hear that I enjoyed this. I want to hear this. God wants to hear this. Pastor, I'm taking that to heart and I'm going to do something. I'm going to be a goer. I'm not sitting and soaking and hiding and hoarding any longer. Because see, If we don't be a doer of what we've heard today, and I realize that some of you may feel like, well, this is news to me. I really didn't know I was commissioned to do this. I thought I had to have a sheepskin and a turnaround collar and talk funny and slick my hair back and wear a three-piece suit and be a preacher. No! But if we don't do this, and we just hear it, this church is going to remain in iniquity and under condemnation and punishment. According to the Word of God, lukewarm, stagnant, and we're going to die and dry up with our little handful. And when the trumpet toots, we're going to stand before God. And now, some of y'all will go eat chicken today, and y'all are going to talk about what he just loved the line. I ain't going back. And that person sitting beside you on their way to hell 100 miles an hour, you eat your chicken right on. That don't bother you. Don't let what I say bother you about the sheep if you're going to let somebody go to hell that you know and love. Listen, let's not be so politically correct up in here. To the point we let people die and go to hell. If y'all don't take this message and do it and just be a hearer of it, we're not going to grow. We've been here 8 years. How many of you found out people ain't knocking the windows out to get in here to see what we look like? Have I told you the truth today?
Amen.
All except, I might as well be mine there at the end. We can edit that out if that's going to offend anybody. Can't we take it? Said, can't we tell you?
I've been there.
He's listening.
You're commissioned by Jesus to go and tell, go and share. We're not doing right hiding and hoarding, sitting and sucking. The woods are full. As Pastor Don says, go get you one. Go pick them up and bring them. I guarantee you there's enough Holy Ghost in here, they'll probably get saved. We'll love on them right where they are. We're not going to clean the fish before we catch them. Bring in the prostitute, the drug addict, the homosexual, the spike hair, the no hair, thank God. The drunk, the adulterer, the downcast. Bring them in here. Jesus said, hey, I want my house to be full. If those that think they're so high and mighty won't come, go to the highways and the byways and get the lame and the maimed and the halt, the ones that nobody won't have. God help us to do that. There's enough out there. We just need to get them and bring them and tell them they're welcome. And watch what Jesus does in here. Can somebody say amen?
Amen?
I want you to stand. Lord Jesus, the message is plain today. Are we going to just be a hearer and let it be like any other Sunday message? Go out and keep coming back every Sunday, hoping that the magic Sunday is going to appear when folks just automatically fill all these seats? Or are we going to take your commission to heart and realize that we are not doing right? We're sinning against you when we hide and hoard and sit and soak on the blessings you've given us. It's not right for us to have a whole loaf when there are those outside that have not had a crumb. It is not right for us to boast about living water when it will not even give us enough life to motivate us to tell somebody that's dying to please have a drink. How can we have the joy of the Holy Ghost with people dying all around us going to hell? God, help us to take this message to heart. Help us to be legacy outreach. In Jesus' name.